If you're one of my 20 subscribers,
thank you, by the way,
then you may be wondering why the hell I've chosen to analyze a documentary this time around. One, it is, yet it isn't part of that genre. Two, true crime documentaries are exhibiting a rather alarming trend by failing to mention pivotal details, i.e., Making a Murderer and Tiger King. For you see, there's a stark difference between cutting a storyline because it diverts from the plot, and purposefully leaving out evidence in order to make the accused party more sympathetic, i.e. Stephen Avery and Joe Exotic. So I want to take a look at the Netflix film Casting JonBenet to see what it got right, what it got wrong, and what it all means symbolically. FYI, there's a lot of details in this case, and details that in the grand scheme of things don't really matter. It just kind of supports a theory. So I'm going to be cherry picking a lot of clues and facts just because I don't have all day, and I don't want to drive myself crazy with this analysis. It's taken long enough already. And no, it's not because I don't believe in my opinion or I don't have the evidence to back it up. It's just because of time that I can't go into everything. So, without further ado, let's look at the real story behind Casting JonBenet. From the moment Little Miss America was born, several described her as a dainty, girly girl on the outside and a free-spirited tomboy on the inside. JonBenet Patricia Ramsey was born on August 6, 1990, to two incredibly wealthy parents. Her father, John Ramsey, was the president and chief executive officer for Axis Graphics. Her mother, Patsy Paw, was the winner of the 1977 Miss West Virginia pageant. She earned herself a bachelor's degree in journalism soon after. How ironic! John and Patsy were 14 years apart in age. Oh, but that didn't stop their whirlwind romance from blossoming into Till Death Do Us Part. They became Mr. and Mrs. Ramsey on November 5th, 1980. 7 years later, Patsy Ramsey gave birth to their oldest, Burke Ramsey. It was pretty clear from the get-go which child she favored. JonBenet was the apple to her mother's eye, so much so that Patsy decided to enter her daughter into child pageantry. Little girls caked in makeup and taking part in risque categories such as swimwear isn't unusual among Southern families. As troublesome as it is, child pageantry has remained a long-standing tradition since the 1960s. Although many were horrified when JonBenet Ramsey's performances aired across the nation, this not only shaped how she was perceived, but how her parents were perceived. In 1993, Patsy got diagnosed with stage 4 ovarian cancer. She underwent a tremendous amount of experimental treatment at the National Institutes of Health. The stress of knowing you only have a 5-year survival rate to see your children grow up must have been incomprehensible. John Ramsey was also experiencing heartache as his daughter from a previous marriage, Beth Ramsey, had passed away in a car accident. She was only 22 years old. John was gutted, but felt like he had reached the other side by the time December 26, 1996 rolled around. Casting JonBenet can't be easily defined when it comes to assigning it a genre. Sometimes the film is a small-town folktale mixed with a dash of horror. Other times, it's a fly-on-the-wall case study on how frivolous gossip can result in real-world consequences. Casting JonBenet never quite knows what it wants to be, but that's where the beauty lies. The film isn't tied down to any absolutes. It alternatively includes all the possibilities. The filmmaker Kitty Green takes a therapeutic approach by listening to every participant without judgment. The interviews are presented in an intimate 4:3 aspect ratio to heighten authenticity. Contrarywise, the auditions use an industry standard 16:9 aspect ratio. ratio to invoke the crime's fictionalized drama.
At times, the film felt like watching one of my grandma's soap operas. Until abruptly realizing this is exactly how sensationalism can destroy real lives. Fun! Casting JonBenet opens with a melancholy tune reminiscent of something you might hear at a ballet. At the film's tail end, JonBenet Ramsey performs her swan song to There She Is, Miss America, adorned from head to toe in white feathers. I couldn't find whether Swan Lake was or wasn't an intentional reference, but it's an interesting choice, if so. Odette holds a great deal of innocence. She starts off as a cursed swan during the day and a tortured maiden at night. Another human must declare eternal love for her to break the spell.
However, the prince agrees to marry the heartless Odile instead of living happily ever after with his one true love, Odette.
It's then hinted at she commits suicide during the show's finale. Overall, Odette is presented as a tragic figure whose heart is just too pure for this cruel world. If that image doesn't perfectly resemble the media's depiction of JonBenet, then I don't know what does. At 5:52 a.m., Patsy declared to a police dispatcher that her precious daughter had been kidnapped. The call was deemed suspicious due to the mere fact she hung up before law enforcement arrived. Hanging up on a dispatcher isn't a cut and dry giveaway per se, but it can raise some red flags.
Rick French and Paul Reichenbach were on the scene first.
Both observed John Ramsey staying relatively calm and Patsy Ramsey edging toward hysteria. Rick and Paul eventually asked them to recount the events leading up to the 911 call.
"'Twas the night before Christmas, when all through the house, not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse."
The family arrived back from a close friend's festive party after 9 o'clock p.m. Because JonBenet had fallen asleep during the drive home, John figured it would be best to carry her straight upstairs. Patsy finished what he started by undressing JonBenet for bed. Both mother and daughter were fast asleep by the time John got Burke ready for bed. At dawn, Patsy Ramsey descended downstairs in order to make a cup of coffee for the busy day ahead.
All four family members were planning to fly via private jet from Frosty, Colorado to sunny Florida.
There, they would board the Big Red Boat, a family-friendly experience run by Premier Cruise Line.
Any excitement for the day ahead quickly dissipated after Patsy discovered a 2.5-page ransom note written from a notepad found inside the home.
The first page demanded $118,000 for JonBenet Ramsey's release. The second emphasized not to contact law enforcement. And finally, the third advised John Ramsey not to underestimate the kidnappers. Patsy was heavily criticized for dialing 911 due to what was emphasized on the second page. Although, what was she supposed to do? Her six-year-old daughter's life was in imminent danger. Patsy probably assumed what any normal person would. The police are the police. They'll know what to do. Oh. How wrong she was. Boulder, Colorado is a small town hidden among the Rocky Mountains. It has an insanely low homicide rate, which might explain why the crime scene was in complete and utter disarray. The police allowed Patsy to invite not one, not two, but five friends over for moral support. One of which was a frickin' reverend. People in turn condemned Patsy Ramsey's decision, but how could she have known? Law enforcement never offered any opposition. They even permitted anyone and everyone to wander wherever, whenever, never intervening. To put it bluntly, the case never had a fair shot to begin with. By the time noon came and went, investigators left Linda Arndt in charge of a household full of civilians.
Why?
Obviously overwhelmed by the arrangement, she asked one of the family's many friends, Fleet White, if he could keep John Ramsey's mind occupied by searching for anything out of the ordinary,
bottom to top. John decided to try the wine cellar. Inside, he found a body wrapped in a white blanket. It was JonBenet Ramsey. Fleet touched her ankle. She was as cold as the ice on the family's front lawn. Nevertheless, John raced JonBenet upstairs to Linda, thinking she was somehow still alive. When Linda informed John and Patsy their daughter was indeed dead, the Reverend prayed aloud, all while Patsy screamed at him to raise her baby from the dead. The coroner concluded JonBenet had died from asphyxia by strangulation, associated with craniocerebral trauma. Whew, that's a mouthful. Needless to say, this case has been studied up, down, sideways, longways, slantways, you name it. Personally, my money is on John Douglas and Lou Smith's hypothesis. Mentioned briefly in my analysis, the real story behind Psycho, John was one of the first to join the FBI's behavioral science unit. His signature practices brought the likes of the Green River Killer, the Tylenol poisoner, and the Atlanta child murderer behind bars. He's considered to be a pioneer in modern-day criminal profiling. Lou, meanwhile, had a 90% clearance rate on more than 200 cases, including the murder of Kelsey Grammer's sister, Karen Grammer. From a tape featured in JonBenet Ramsey, What Really Happened, Lou Smith vents his frustrations by expressing that, "This investigation, I really believe, has been going the wrong way all these months, and that's the problem of the case. It's not being solved because they have focused on the Ramseys and don't want to unfocus." Lou speculated JonBenet's murder was the result of a stalker who had gone too far. The intruder entered through an already broken window and brought a stun gun as an efficient way to paralyze her. In theory, this would explain why no one heard JonBenet scream and how two mysterious dots ended up on her face. John Douglas, on the other hand, detailed a slightly different scenario in The Cases That Haunt Us. JonBenet Ramsey's killer was a white male, relatively young, who had a personal grudge against John Ramsey and intended to carry it out by defiling and robbing him of the most valuable thing in the world to him. I believe he entered the house while the family was out, either through the basement window well or with a key, bringing with him a stun gun, a roll of duct tape, and a spool of cord. His intention was to incapacitate JonBenet, abduct her, and molest her. This was a personal cause crime rather than a criminal enterprise. The ransom consideration was secondary and may not have even occurred to the unsub until he was in the house. This could account for the notes being written on Patsy's pad, and this could account for the $118,000 figure. That is, he had no real intention of collecting so low a sum. He was just trying to make a point. I honestly think John's theory rings truer, but that's just me. So why did law enforcement ignore the possibility of an intruder if the family were in fact innocent? Three words: statistics and rivalry. It's very common for investigators to start with the victim's relationships before moving on to strangers, simply due to statistical probability. John Ramsey was adamant his wife wasn't well enough to interview 2 days after JonBenet Ramsey's death. Patsy Ramsey was heavily sedated out of fear she would seriously injure herself. That didn't deter the police, though. Already suspicious, they held JonBenet's body hostage in exchange for an interview with Patsy. Close friend and retired police officer Michael Bynum took notice of law enforcement's harsh actions towards otherwise grieving parents. He recommended they lawyer up. The police were pissed, as they could no longer have a direct line to the family. Growing distrustful of law enforcement, John and Patsy, still medicated, decided to get the media involved by breaking their silence on CNN. That was the nail in the coffin as far as the police were concerned. You know, I was genuinely shocked to learn how many felt casting JonBenet was pure exploitation. I think that alone says more about them than Kitty Green herself. She isn't afraid to hold up a mirror to the world's sick consumption of sensationalism. It's exploitative, but that's only because the actual case was massively exploited. One of the reasons why Kitty began her little venture was due to watching numerous made-for-TV films on the case. She wondered how the cast could have possibly immersed themselves in a puzzle missing several crucial pieces. Truth is, They can't. Nobody can. We'll probably never know what happened to the all-American girl in Rhinestones. All we have are interpretations of what happened based on individual life experiences. The JonBenet Ramsey case is an American tale, like Swan Lake is for Russia. Each time the story is retold through different cultures and under different circumstances, we unknowingly morph it into our desired version.
Whether that calls for a happier ending or the villains getting what they deserve, the original myth ultimately becomes lost, and the people's adaptation is born.
Thank you guys so much for watching. This was so much fun to do because I am just fascinated with this case, and it was a lot of fun to do a deep dive into. Also, if you have any ideas for any upcoming videos related to true crime, let me know in the comment section below. Please like this video, subscribe, and ring the bell to get notified about any other videos I do. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye, guys!